Completely landlocked by Italy, the tiny nation of San Marino is easy to overlook. When your neighbors with Venice, Florence, Bologna, and other famous Italian destinations, it can be difficult to stand out and catch the attention of travelers. San Marino remains the least visited country in Europe, but a visit here means you get to tick another country off your bucket list. Hey there, poor traveler! We are Vince and Josh. San Marino is the third smallest country in Europe, but you might still want to consider spending at least a day here. In this video, we'll share with you some of the things to do and places to visit if you don't have that much time. In our previous video, we already tackled how to get to San Marino from key cities in Italy. If you haven't seen that yet, you might want to give it a watch first. You can find the link in the description. And oh, don't forget to like this page if you're on FB, or subscribe to this channel if you're on YouTube, and tap the bell icon to get notified when we upload new travel videos. The bus to San Marino terminates here, near the entrance to the old town. From this point, the attractions that I'm gonna mention in this video are arranged chronologically, starting from the bus stop. Think of it as a walking trail. You may skip some of these stops. We're just laying out the key attractions along the route, but if you want to skip a site for whatever reason, move on to the next stop. A few of these attractions are not open to the public, but we still included them so you could admire from the outside or take photos. But feel free to follow or tweak it according to your needs and preferences. And oh, expect a long uphill hike and some stairs. The old town of San Marino City is perched on top of Monte Titano or Mount Titan, so the ground is largely uneven. Now that we have that out of the way, let's start. From the bus stop, one of the first structures you'll spot is the Convento dei Frati Cappuccini, which overlooks the first hairpin turn to the top. From the convento, follow the road to the next hairpin bend and you'll find an arch. Walk through it and up a short alley and you'll emerge at Piazza Sant'Agata. This small unassuming square is surrounded by sandstone structures including the Teatro Titano building to the left and a small portico. The centerpiece is the Girolamo Gozzi Monument, which features a bronze statue of the Captain Regent and a bronze relief of other freedom fighters behind it. From here, you may choose to visit the Museum of Medieval Criminology and Torture or simply the Torture Museum, Porta San Francesco, an iconic watchtower built in 1361 that serves as the main gate to the city, a Roman Catholic Church also built in 1361, Museo Pinacoteca San Francesco, a museum and gallery inaugurated in 1966. Museo di Stato, or State Museum or National Museum, which exhibits around 5,000 pieces of art and historic artifacts. And the National Gallery of Modern and Contemporary Art, with over 700 art pieces in various forms and media. Just across the National Gallery of Modern and Contemporary Art, before reaching the road curve, is the Cava dei Balestrieri, or Crossbowmen's Quarry. It's an outdoor theater that features carved walls and cultural events like Palio of the Old Crossbow, a crossbow competition with participants in medieval costumes, held in September. It's also the site for other festivals and open-air exhibitions. Just around the corner is the Borghese Monument. The area also serves as an observation spot where you can admire the panoramic view of the towns below and the surrounding area. Nearby is a cable car station. The aerial tramway or funicular runs between Borgo Maggiore, where the base station is, and the city of San Marino, where the upper station is located. The cable car system has two gondolas, which can accommodate up to 50 passengers each and operate every 15 minutes. It was first launched in 1959 and has undergone two renovations. The latest was in 2017. The travel duration from the base station to the upper station is about 2 minutes. You can even travel down to Borgo Maggiore if you wish. Close to the upper station is the San Marino Tourism Office, where you can get a passport stamp. It's not compulsory. The Republic has no hard border, ergo, no border checkpoints, ergo, no entry stamps. But you can get a souvenir stamp for 5 euro. This is the only place in the world where you can obtain a San Marino stamp. However, consider having the stamp on a separate booklet or on an expired passport instead of your current one. Some embassies take issue with unofficial stamps, so better safe than sorry. Drop by the San Marino Basilica, the city's main church. This neoclassical church's origin dates back to the 7th century, but the present structure was built in the 1830s. It's dedicated to the nation's patron saint, Saint Marinus. Just a short walk from there, the pathway opens up to the wide Piazza della Libertà. The square features the Liberty statue in the middle and the politically significant structure, the Palazzo Pubblico. From the square, tourists stop to marvel at the scenic view of the city and the surrounding hills and mountains. You will find shops, cafes, and restaurants in the area. This is a good time to have lunch. There are plenty of food places around. If money isn't an issue, you can dine at a restaurant for a proper lunch, or if you're on a shoestring budget, you can grab a quick bite. You can find establishments offering a quick meal for less than 10 euro. After lunch, it's time to tour the towers. San Marino has three iconic towers that are all situated atop the three peaks of Monte Titano in the city center. The nation's flag and coat of arms both bear the image of these three towers. The 11th century Guaita Tower, which was shortly used as a prison, is the first and the oldest of the three. It is also the most popular. You will also see drawings or scribbles done by the former prisoners on some walls. From the tower, you will be rewarded with a panoramic view of the city and beyond. From the first tower, take the Paso del Estregue, a narrow passage on the way to the second tower. It's best known for its snap-worthy rock bridge that connects the cliffs. Also called Frata but marked on Google Maps as Falesia Second Tower, the 13th century Cesta Tower sits atop the highest peak of Monte Titano. It also features a museum, which is Museo delle Armi Antiche, which exhibits over 1,000 items related to weaponry and artillery, encompassing those from the medieval era up to the present time. If you also plan on visiting the two towers, the St. Francis Museum and the National Gallery of Modern and Contemporary Art, consider grabbing a combined ticket which costs 10.5 euro. If you're only interested in just one or two, then just buy single tickets. The third tower is the 14th century Montale Tower, perched on the smallest peak of Monte Titano. Tourists can't go inside the tower as the only entryway is located about 7 meters from the ground, but taking photos of the tower and the view from the outside is allowed. After checking out all three towers, it's time to call it a day. To return to Rimini, simply trace your steps back to the piazza where you can catch the bus to Rimini Station. Alight at Rimini Stazione. Note that this bus does not terminate here. The last stop is actually Piazza Marvelli, so make sure you alight at the right stop. From Rimini Station, board the train back to your origin or your next destination. If you need more information about traveling around San Marino, Italy, or Europe in general, you'll find comprehensive travel guides with sample itineraries on our website, www.theportraveler.net, or check out the links in the description. If you have questions, make good use of the comment section below. If you have a Spotify account or Apple Podcasts app, follow and tune in to the Poor Traveler Podcast. You can also find us on Instagram, TikTok, Facebook, Twitter, and of course, YouTube. Just look for @thepoortraveler, single L. That's all for now. Remember, plan smart, travel safe, and make every trip worth it.